Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to the 15th David Tillinghast lecture at the New York University School of Law. This is the signal event of the International Tax Program, and I'm particularly happy to see so many people here tonight, alumni, friends, all of we happy few who pay attention to taxation and tax policy. As I said, this is the 15th. I am David Rosenblum. I'm the director. I don't know all of you, so I should introduce myself. I am going to, in a minute, introduce our speaker, Professor Dan Shaviro, who is the Wayne Perry Professor here at New York University School of Law. Before I do so, though, I think I do want to spend one moment taking note of the founder, whom I consider the founder of the International Tax Program, Paul McDaniel, who passed away this year in Florida just a few months ago. Paul's contribution to this program is just immeasurable, was just immeasurable. Many of you know, he went on after leaving New York University to found a second international tax program down at the University of Florida. He was an absolute giant in this field, in which I think we probably all have at least enough of an interest to come here this evening. And I just want to take one moment to really just honor his memory, his contribution, and my profound respect for everything he did. I also want to express, as I do every year, my admiration, respect for the namesake of our lecture, David Tillinghast, whom I have always considered the leading international tax practitioner in the United States, and a good friend, I'm happy to say, for many years. And so I welcome you all for this event, which to me is always very, very great deal of pleasure, and I can promise you it's going to be good tonight, because we had our normal luncheon meeting with the students, and we had quite a lively debate. So without more, I'm going to turn to our speaker, who, as I said, is Daniel Shaviro, who is the Wayne Perry Professor of Taxation, a leading author and professor on topics of taxation, a person whom I'm happy to say I used to work with in my law firm many years ago, who has a background of working in government on the Joint Committee staff, and who has authored a succession of highly regarded books on taxation. Certainly one of the leading commentators in this country on the subject that we're going to be considering tonight. Dan is going to talk to us about the rising tax electivity of U.S. corporate residents. And I'm going to turn the floor over to him and let him explain what that means to you. Thanks, Dan.
Well, thanks so much, David, for that kind introduction. I also want to thank both you and David Tillinghast for arranging this and inviting me to speak. I'd like to thank all of you for coming today. It's a very nice day outside. And finally, I'd like to pay my own respects as well to Paul McDaniel, who we used to call our wartime consigliere here in the internet, in the founding days of the International Tax Program. Okay, on to the main event. In 1975, Bill Gates moved to New Mexico and founded Microsoft there. This was a mistake. As William Woods recently noted while serving as the head of the Bermuda Stock Exchange, and I quote, "Gates would be fabulously wealthier if he had started Microsoft in Bermuda. His ignorance about tax cost him a fortune. Mr. Gates has not done badly even so, but he knows better now. The new company that he recently co-founded is now incorporated in Bermuda," end quote. Now, self-serving though it may be for a Bermuda Stock Exchange official to tout incorporating there, Woods had an undeniable point. U.S. corporate residence for federal income tax purposes, which is based on U.S. incorporation, has major tax disadvantages for a company. It makes you potentially taxable in the U.S. on foreign source income, and it makes it harder to disguise U.S. income as actually having been earned abroad. So if you're thinking of incorporating a potentially global business here, the U.S. tax lawyer's advice will usually be, don't. And people increasingly follow this advice. Now, if U.S. corporate residence becomes ever more avoidable, that's bad news for the worldwide tax that the U.S. at least putatively imposes. You can't effectively tax and attribute U.S. corporate residence that people are too willing to do without. So we need to examine and think about the possibility that U.S. corporate residence is becoming ever more elective as global markets increasingly integrate and Americans, among others, become increasingly willing to hold foreign stock. Now, even if electivity reached very high levels, it would only be for new corporate equity. Existing U.S. companies generally can't get out of the worldwide system unless they're genuinely purchased by a foreign company. Getting back to Bill Gates and Microsoft, I doubt they'd hand themselves over to a separate foreign purchaser just for tax reasons, so they're pretty much stuck here, unlike new equity or a new U.S. company. So that's my topic for today, the rising tax electivity of U.S. corporate residents and how it differently affects new equity as compared to existing equity. This gives me four topics for the rest of my talk. The first is, what do I mean by electivity of U.S. corporate residents? The second is, why might we want a worldwide residence-based system if electivity doesn't make it impossible or too ineffective? What are the stakes here? Third, how far have we gone towards electivity, and with what implications for the worldwide system? And finally, transition. What should we do about existing U.S. companies if we shift to a territorial system? Okay, so my first of these four topics is defining tax electivity. And you can kind of distinguish between formal or explicit electivity and substantive electivity. Formal or explicit electivity means that you kind of look at your tax return, and in the strong case, there's a box that says, check here if you want result A, don't check here if you want result B. That's formal electivity. And we actually have that in a few limited circumstances in U.S. law. The big example international is certain types of legal entities other than corporations, the taxpayer is allowed to explicitly elect whether it should be regarded as a corporation or not for U.S. tax purposes. So that's an explicit election. It's been widely used to create so-called hybrid entities, foreign subsidiaries is too judgmental a word, foreign companies owned by a U.S. parent that the U.S. thinks don't exist because of the election that the taxpayer took on the U.S. tax return, but that the foreign country does think exists as a separate company. And this turns out to have major tax planning advantages for taxpayers. So it's been a subject of controversy. So that's an explicit election. But suppose that you had an explicit election that had adverse non-tax consequences. The point I want to make here is that what really matters is what I call substantive electivity, not formal or explicit. For example, suppose U.S. corporate residents were explicitly elective. Suppose it depended just on a box on your tax return where you would say, I want to be a U.S. company, I don't want to be a U.S. company. But suppose that it turned out that if you elected not to be a U.S. company, this would have really bad effects on you in other ways. For example, there'd be congressional hearings, you'd be called a Benedict Arnold, your CEO would be dressed down in public, consumers would rise and boycott your products. Not a realistic picture, of course, but the point I'm making is that what really matters is substantive electivity or the ability to make the preferred tax choice without adverse non-tax consequences. So what do I mean by substantive electivity? You have a situation where if you do X, you get tax result A, but if you do Y, you get tax result B. So it's kind of not formally elective. Whichever one you do, that tells you the tax consequence. But suppose that you're genuinely indifferent between X and Y. You're equally happy doing either one, taxes aside. Then really, tax is the only factor you have to think about to make the choice. An example to illustrate this idea is gain and appreciated stock. So you hold stock that's appreciated, you're going to, in theory, be taxed when you sell it, but you won't be taxed until and unless you sell it. So if it's not formally elective, if you sell it, you're taxed. If you don't sell it, you're not taxed. Well, why would you do anything other than the right tax answer, which is not to sell it if it's appreciated and you don't want to have the gain in your income? The question is, what does selling do for you? And it does a bunch of things like you get cash, you change your risk position, maybe, though it's unlikely for public companies, you care about the voting rights in the stock, maybe their transaction costs of the deal. So there are various reasons why it might matter, taxes aside, whether you sell the stock or not. And that makes it harder to just do what your tax lawyer tells you. But the greater the degree to which you can get the true economic result you want, without regard to whether you do something that the tax system calls a sale or not, the more it's really elective. And you could imagine a point at which your lawyer tells you, for 5 cents, You can get whatever economic results you want, cash in hand, changing your risk profile so you're not subject to the stock. You can get whatever you like. You can do it with a sale or you can do it without a sale. It makes no difference to us or to you. That would be a case where realizing gain on the sale of appreciated stock would be completely elective as a substantive matter, because by hypothesis, you wouldn't care whether you did that which the tax system regards as a sale or not. So the only reason to care would be for the tax consequences. That would be basically an election in my usage. Now, there are actually tax rules that try to make it less elective than it would otherwise be whether you have a sale or not. There are various things people tried to do to get the economics of a sale without actually being regarded by the tax system as having done one. So a statute was passed to say if you do too much of this stuff, it's a sale for tax purposes. And that reduced the electivity of a sale of stock for tax purposes relative to what it would have been if that statute didn't exist. So electivity is really about the ability to just get whatever economics you want and separately get whatever tax result you want. Now, obviously, electivity is not an either-or thing. It's not that everything in the world is elective or it isn't. It's a matter of degree. The question is, how much does getting the tax consequences you want require you to do things you wouldn't otherwise want to do? So you could think of it in terms of an exercise price. How much you have to pay to get the preferred tax result, whether you pay in the sense of having transaction costs, paying lawyers and accountants to arrange it, or whether it's a fee in the sense that you don't have the position you want. You have to do something you didn't want to do that, in theory, you would have paid money not to do. In that sense, substantive elections in the tax law can have an exercise price in the sense that you may actually have to do something you don't want to do to get them, to get the preferred tax result, and that, of course, will affect the extent to which people are willing to do it. Now, turning to U.S. corporate residents, that is, of course, formally non-elective. There is no box in the tax return saying, I choose to be a U.S. company, I choose not to be. Is it substantively elective, at least for a new company going forward? Well, in fact, whether you're a U.S. company or not basically depends on whether you were incorporated in the U.S. So the question is there any reason to care whether you're incorporated in the U.S.? If there were no reason to care at all, it would essentially be an election. If it matters a lot for non-tax purposes, then it's much less elective. So our own Mitch Cain and a corporate law prof from Penn named Ed Rock wrote an article about how we should decide what a resident corporation is in terms of not messing up the international market for corporate control and the like. They came up with a terminology that's moderately helpful. Say a company is deciding where to incorporate, they have to think about the corporate surplus versus the tax surplus. They get tax surplus in the site, whether it's incorporating the U.S. or the Caymans or Bermuda or France. They get tax surplus from the place that will make their taxes be lower, but they get corporate surplus if the company will otherwise be more valuable, or you could add if the managers will otherwise be happier or anything like that. So they have to compare the corporate surplus to the tax surplus if they're on opposite sides of the ledger, and they'll go for the one that's bigger. So you could think of high electivity as the case where the corporate surplus of doing one thing or the other is very low, where it really doesn't matter whether you're incorporated in the U.S. or not. So what potentially limits the electivity of U.S. corporate residents, at least for starting with a new company here, is how much you have reason to care whether you incorporate here or not, how much it means to you taxes aside. Why would anyone care about why they incorporate in the U.S.? Well, there are a bunch of reasons. It could affect your operating costs. You're in New York, you're a small operation, do you have to go to a Bermuda corporate lawyer? It could affect corporate law quality. Which you might care about for its own sake or as a branding matter. Investors aren't going to come in if they think you went to low-quality corporate law. It could affect your access to U.S. capital markets, though it's certainly true that these days foreign companies can cross-list and access the U.S. market. It might matter due to investors' home equity bias. If there are people you want to sell shares to or Americans who only buy U.S. stock, that becomes an argument for U.S. incorporation. So all these factors might affect how elective it is, whether or not you incorporate in the U.S., and will affect the extent to which you can just drive the decision on tax consequences. So that's the question of electivity. How, to what extent are people constrained to use a U.S. Incorporation, even where for tax reasons it would be bad? When will they not be able to do the tax optimal thing because there are too many other stakes? Well, there are four different settings, though we'll end up caring about only three of them, where this might be an issue. The obvious one is determining place of incorporation of a new startup. You have a new company, you have a new business that you think has global potential. If the business will only be operating in the U.S., there's no reason not to incorporate here. But if you think the business is global potential, you have to decide, should we incorporate in the U.S., Bermuda, or the Caymans, Germany, Spain, where should we do it? So determining the place of incorporation of a new startup. a second setting, which didn't resonate with my experience, but a leading practitioner wrote an interesting piece that I'll be referring to a little later, named Lou Steinberg, talked about what he called the reverse endowment effect. He says that a lot of foreign companies are kind of dying to move into the U.S. and become U.S. companies. He gives the example of Murdoch's News Corporation. So a foreign company that wants to come in, taxes aside, obviously is going to decide whether they will or not. The third example, which is a pretty important one, is expatriation by an existing U.S. company. You have an existing U.S. company, and they may decide, we don't want to be a U.S. company anymore. Or more precisely, we don't want any of our foreign operations to be under the umbrella of a U.S. company. We want to do a corporate inversion such that perhaps a Bermuda company is the parent. All the foreign subsidiaries belong to it in the chain of ownership, and the U.S. operations are off to the side. That was affected by a statute I'll refer to, again, Section 7874, that made this a lot harder to do. Now, the fourth setting, which the word electivity sounds least apt for, but I think it's really the same phenomenon you have to think about it, is the issuance of new equity to fund investment by a U.S. or a foreign company. So suppose this is a real-world example of a sort, not that I know anything inside about this example, but that China wanted to build an electric grid, and they're offering a huge contract to whichever company from around the world could offer them the best bid. So suppose that GE, a U.S. company, or Siemens, a German company, are the two companies most likely to do this, and suppose that they're going, how are they going to fund it? Well, since debt financing gets us into a bunch of other issues I'd rather leave aside from now, suppose really either company is going to sell new equity in order to finance the project. It doesn't look like an election about whether to use a U.S. company or German company. After all, each company will figure out its best bid, and then the Chinese will pick whichever one they like better. But if you really think it through, it turns out it's really being just like electivity. It's kind of, do the people who are doing this find out that it makes most sense to do it through a U.S. company or a non-U.S. company? GE and Siemens, in trying to sell equity, are going to have to do so on world equity markets, where people are concerned with the after-all-taxes return. And despite the fact that it doesn't sound like it's an election when they both make a bid and China picks the favored bid, it really amounts to the same thing about whether business ends up being done through a U.S. or a non-U.S. company, and one of the factors affecting this is going to be the so-called the negative tax surplus from doing the U.S., assuming the other country has less favorable rules, versus whatever the corporate surplus considerations one way or the other are. So that's the fourth setting that I have in mind. It's an important one for the overall story. Okay, so that brings me to topic two. I go to purple whenever I have a new topic. Hopefully I've explained adequately what I mean by electivity. The second topic is, why would we be interested in having residence-based worldwide corporate taxation, that which is potentially undermined by electivity? Why would we be interested in this? Why would it be something the U.S. might want to do if not constrained by the problems of getting anyone to sign up for U.S. corporate residence? Well, to assess that, you have to kind of think about why we'd want to have a residence-based worldwide tax. So the U.S. Has a question. There are these various resident taxpayers, individuals, of course, but I'm really interested here in corporations, and I'll explain why. Why would the U.S. potentially want to have a worldwide tax on these taxpayers, not just a tax on U.S. income? Well, but the important thing to keep in mind, and really important to the analysis, is that we're not talking about whether individuals should be taxed on the worldwide income. The question here is whether, since global business is very largely done through corporations that are taxed as separate taxpayers, we're really talking about a worldwide corporate tax on resident corporations. Why might we want to have such a thing as that? That's the question that we're asking. Why would the U.S. or another country potentially want to have a worldwide tax in that setting? Well, how can this be kind of a throwaway topic in the middle of this lecture? The worldwide versus territorial aspect has been debated for 50 more years. It's been debated at length, perhaps ad nauseum. But I think without sufficiently focusing on why it matters that the tax on a resident's worldwide business income that would be done on a residence basis unless the country opts for a more territorial system, we're really talking about an entity-level tax based on corporate residence. That's vital to the analysis, and yet often ignored. I think you can read a lot of the literature, especially until recently, and kind of forget that corporations are in the story at all, and imagine it's just about individuals. It would kind of make no difference for reading the literature. Well, when people debate worldwide versus, when they talk about a territorial system versus a worldwide system, They often talk about, I should really use the phrase global welfare to avoid confusing worldwide, which I'm using for worldwide income. How is the tax policy issue generally teed up? Really in terms of, there are these worldwide welfare efficiency norms, capital export neutrality, capital import neutrality, capital ownership neutrality. Since I suspect this lecture will take long enough anyway, I will not attempt to say what each of these norms is or why it is that particular ones come out in favor of a worldwide tax, whereas others come out in favor of a territorial tax. Because the point I want to make is that this is quite an unsatisfying way to do tax policy. We don't really do that in domestic tax policy. To have like a single one-purpose welfare norm based on one particular decision that you're hoping taxpayers will make neutrally. Worst of all, in terms of this being really a coherent and useful guide, and by the way, this was the topic of one of the most memorable Tillinghast lectures some years ago, given by Michael Gratz, is why would worldwide welfare be the standard for national policymaking when you would think that national considerations would be paramount? Similarly, when I write about tax policy in a more philosophic vein, I often will write from a utilitarian standpoint where everyone's welfare counts the same. But when I make my personal family budgetary and life decisions, I have to admit I'm not a pure utilitarian. No, I actually think more about what's good for me and for my family. I try not to hurt other people and the like. None of us really act as if the entire world matters equally with ourselves, even though we know that in moral truth it does. And I think the same thing is really true for a country. You can't really expect a country to be making policy on the basis of worldwide welfare rather than, to a large degree, national welfare. And as I've talked about elsewhere, what I think when people claim that U.S. international tax policy should be decided on worldwide welfare grounds, they're not actually naive altruists. They're not, for example, saying that the U.S. should give all its money to very poor countries in sub-Saharan Africa that actually could use it if they would find a way to use it well. What they're really talking about is cooperative rather than unilateral strategies for promoting national welfare. In other words, we're nice to you, you're nice to us back, we end up both better off. So the way I want to address this issue is to say, is to ask, what unilaterally promotes national welfare? What rule? And secondarily, could multilateral cooperation improve the outcome? If there's something we do it by ourselves, but everyone does the same thing, we all end up in a box. Are there cooperative abilities to make things better? And another thing I'm going to do that's different than the usual debate is I want to touch on distribution issues as well as efficiency. If all we cared about is efficiency, we could have a uniform lump sum head tax and be done, apart from the problem of collecting it from people who don't have anything. But obviously distribution matters. Why do we have an income tax? Why might we consider having a consumption tax or anything like that? It's because distribution matters. We have taxes we know are inefficient, discourage earning income and things like that. We do it because it's part of the trade-off for having an appropriate policy distributionally. So I think distribution issues need to be part of it. But when we talk about distribution issues here in relation to corporate tax, we have to keep in mind that we don't really care about entities directly in distributional terms. We only care, or should only care, or I certainly would argue for only caring about individuals. Legal entities don't actually live anywhere. There's no corporation that actually lives in the U.S. or anywhere else. Corporations can't feel pleasure or pain. Only people can. So when you're talking about distribution, you're talking about people. But you're doing it through the vehicle of a tax that's not directly on people. It's on these legal entities. Okay, so I propose a two-stage analysis here. The first question is, suppose we tax individuals directly on corporate income, a partnership tax model. If we did this, it's unrealistic, of course, or at least it's never been done, but I think it's an important step conceptually to imagine initially that that's what we're doing. Say, if we were doing that, what would be the motives for having worldwide rather than merely territorial taxation? So what I mean by this is, for example, you have U.S. and German individuals, and they own stock in both GE and Siemens. If we had a worldwide residence-based tax with flow through from the entity level to individuals, what we'd be saying is that we're going to tax Americans on their, a worldwide system would mean we were taxing Americans on their non-US income from both GE and Siemens. Of course, hypothetically, we're flowing it through, so there's no corporate tax return, except the reporting kind of a partnership return today. Likewise, we'd be taxing Germans if we have a source-based tax, but we don't purport to tax Germans in their worldwide income. Likewise, if Germans invested in GE and Siemens, doesn't matter which one, in both cases we tax them on their U.S. source income, we wouldn't tax them on any other income. So that's what it would mean to have a worldwide residence-based tax in a world where it was feasible and actually was done that you floated through to individuals. Now, I think this is the scenario, no one's really said this, but I think this is a scenario that's effectively assumed when people write about residence-based corporate taxation but ignore the fact that it's really mainly an entity-level tax. So my question now is, if we did this, which we of course don't, what would be the motives for worldwide taxation of U.S. individuals? Then the second question will be, well, what about the fact that we don't do this? How does the analysis change when we realize that we're imposing tax on the entity level based on corporate residence determinations on the entity level? How does that change the analysis? Does that undermine what we thought before? Okay, so start with U.S. individuals. Who's the only ones who would be subject to this worldwide residence-based U.S. tax, and the question of distribution. And the question is, why do we need to tax any corporate income, including that earned domestically? Why do we have any corporate entity-level tax at all? Why not just have individual income tax and nothing else? Well, if we had a consumption tax in this country, instead of an income tax, it might not be necessary to have a tax on corporate income. You could simply get people when they took the money out and consumed it. But given that we have an income tax, if you don't tax corporate income to someone, corporations would, in effect, be giant IRAs. If you can do your saving in a bank account and you're taxed on it, so you say, oh, I'll put it in corporate stock, if the corporation isn't being taxed on its income and you're not being taxed on your share of its income, you've created a giant individual retirement account, a tax-free savings account that's conditioned on having investing through a corporation. That really wouldn't make any sense. So once you kind of are trying to have an income tax, you really need to tax corporate income one way or another. Now, I'm not going to talk today about the shareholder level double tax, but short of the partnership model, it could work pretty well to have purely an entity level tax. Having an entity level tax, this is a world where they're just Americans investing in the US, having just an entity level tax where the corporations pay tax on the income could be a pretty good proxy for flowing it through to individuals. What differences will it make? Well, it might lead to different tax rate applying, it might lead to different results given that net losses can't be deducted, different results of when net losses are allowed against other income. There are reasons why it would matter, but fundamentally, if you had an entity-level corporate income tax, it's kind of a proxy for taxing individuals, and it means you kind of defended the income tax from the case where you had an individual income tax, no flow-through, and no corporate tax. You've defended the tax system from having a really preposterous hole in it that would make the whole enterprise not worthwhile. Well, the same rationale potentially applies to taxing individuals' foreign source income as for corporate income. If you're trying to tax people on their income, not their consumption, it kind of doesn't make any sense to say, just as it makes no sense to say, well, if you do it through a corporation, no one will be taxed at it until you get it out years later. Likewise, it wouldn't make sense to say, or it would be self-defeating, gash a hole in the thing to say, well, if you're in foreign source income, at least through a corporation, we won't tax it. Well, again, you've shot a hole in the income tax, and given that you have an income tax, you've kind of compromised your own purposes. Thus, there is a distributional motive for worldwide residence-based taxation of individuals. But the thing I've left out so far is, what about foreign taxes on income earned abroad? Suppose, for example, that U.S. individuals can earn foreign income, and I'll give the two stylized examples. They can earn it in Germany, where there are U.S.-style rates, or they can earn it in the Caymans, where there's no significant income tax. Now, from a unilateral U.S. perspective, would you prefer them to invest in Germany and pay high taxes? And the answer is, of course not. Paying taxes to Germany doesn't do us any good. So the fact that they're in some high tax country other than the US, when we're just looking at the US acting unilaterally, makes no difference. In fact, it's worse, because the reason why we often want people, we wish people would invest on a pre-tax basis, is that the taxes paid are a cost to them, but socially it's just a transfer, because the Treasury gets the money and hand it to someone else. If the money goes to another country, your folks don't get the money. So if you're sufficiently selfish to care about your country's well-being, foreign taxes don't do any good. So initially, there's just no reason to care that they might invest in high-tax Germany or low-tax Caymans. Indeed, you probably ought to hope that they get the highest after foreign tax return that they can, because then your country, people of your country will be richest. But suppose we make a deal with Germany, and here's where the multi or bi or multilateral part comes in. You could say to Germany, you could basically say, I've been struggling with whether this is hard to explain non-confusingly. You could say to Germany, we'll exempt our people's foreign source income and you exempt your people's foreign source income. And supposing that the amounts of income involved in the tax are the same, it kind of comes out as a wash to saying instead, we'll exempt in a source base. So to put it this way, if U.S. individuals invest $100 billion in Germany, and it's taxed at 30% there, and German individuals invest earn $100 billion in the U.S., and it's taxed at 30%, we'll keep it the same here. Kind of to say, we'll each exempt foreign source income kind of comes out to really the same, except for the details of the cash flows, each saying we'll exempt your other you guys on investing inbound. Kind of the amounts differ only insofar as the tax rates differ, the amounts of income involved. So coordinating with Germany, if the amounts involved are similar, you might as well say, we'll be nice and exempt your guys from our source-based tax if you exempt ours from yours. That kind of comes out to the same in the end, or I'm simplifying, but it comes out to approximately the same as saying we'll each exempt our foreign source income because we know you're taxing it, so it's not going untaxed. So that's why with cooperation between countries, you actually may care about the German taxes. So this is a deal you can make with Germany, but not with the Caymans. You can kind of say, if the U.S. and Germany are the only countries involved, you can kind of say, gee, we're not going to tax foreign source income, because if it goes to Germany, it'll be taxed anyway, and the Germans come here, it'll be taxed anyway. So it turns out two similar countries can kind of agree. They could mutually agree in a territorial system. Now you kind of would care that it's being taxed in the other country because it's part of a swap you're making with that country. But you can't make this deal with the Caymans, obviously. So that's the only reason you care about foreign taxes, and the reason we get into things like foreign tax credit systems and the like is because you're making some sort of deals with other countries where you're giving a concession, but you're also getting a concession. And the individuals are really not coming out with the ability to avoid the income tax since they're paying it somewhere else. Okay, so that's kind of really why what I see is the distributional rationale for having a worldwide residence-based income tax on individuals. You don't want people to be able to avoid the income tax by investing abroad, subject only to the fact that you can make deals with other comparably high-tax or low-tax countries. What about efficiency? Are there any efficiency reasons for favoring worldwide taxation of resident individuals? And the answer is seemingly yes. You know from the word seemingly, I'm going to go somewhere else. There's been a norm in the literature, and I didn't do CEN, CIN, or CON, but I will do NN, National Neutrality by Peggy Musgrave, which she posited almost 50 years ago, and posited under some circumstances, namely a country acting unilaterally, you actually have efficiency reasons for a worldwide tax. And the argument goes as follows. Suppose we take it as given that there's a source-based tax in the U.S. So income earned in the U.S. will be taxed. And again, you know, kind of repeating what I said before, this tax is a cost from the taxpayer standpoint. If I look at my after-tax to decide how well off I am, but socially it's a transfer. The U.S. Treasury gets the money and they can give it to someone else. So from a U.S. national standpoint, taxpayer incentives are fundamentally distorted if they can avoid this tax by investing abroad. Creates an undesirable incentive structure for the U.S. to say, well, we have the source-based tax here, but you can just avoid it by investing somewhere else. And this seems to suggest a compelling efficiency case for worldwide taxation of your residents. You basically make the tax unavoidable so far as locational choice is concerned. It's true you could not earn income at all. Well, that's a basic problem with an income tax. But by having a worldwide tax, you tell people, you can't avoid it by not investing in the U.S. So just take investing in the U.S. for granted. I'm sorry, just take paying the U.S. tax for granted and invest wherever is best given everything else. So this is a pretty powerful argument, it seems, but nonetheless, it isn't as clearly right as it initially appears. And indeed, as recent literature suggests, it's probably wrong. And I think the best way to explain it is as follows. Suppose we could impose worldwide U.S. taxation on everyone. Well, even recent presidential administrations have never in their drunkest days gone that far. In other words, what I'm proposing here as a thought experiment, not a policy proposal, is we could say everyone in the world is going to pay the U.S. tax no matter where they invest. Germans, 35% if you invest in the U.S., but guess what? It's also 35% if you invest anywhere else. Leaving aside a whole lot of fairly important considerations, international comity, making everyone else, you could probably do the scenario. But in terms of the incentives on investors, this would clearly, just at this margin, this would clearly make sense from the U.S. national standpoint. We would have eliminated the U.S. Source-based tax as a factor in causing people to invest outside the U.S. So this would solve the problem completely that Peggy Richmond Musgrave was talking about. But of course, we can't do that and should be ashamed of ourselves if we even thought about it for more than a hypothetical. So given that's not available, what can we do? Well, the only people we can do this to is our own residents. If we want, we can tax American taxpayers on their whole worldwide income and eliminate the, quote, bad incentive from our standpoint from us. By the way, of course, the bad incentive from our standpoint to the Germans, avoiding U.S. tax, there's nothing wrong with it from their standpoint. It's only from ours because we get the money. That is a bad incentive, and you want to make the U.S. tax unavoidable to anyone who earns income. So we can't make everyone in the world pay the U.S. residents, U.S. worldwide tax. For everyone else, everyone outside the U.S., we can only make them pay if they come here. The result is we're subject to tax competition. We have to worry about the fact that they will be deterred from entering from it. So the question then is, well, what if we call off tax competition for our own residents? We tell them, you, even though we can't make everyone else pay U.S. tax no matter where they invest, we can do it to you. Does this assist the U.S. in this problem of, to its detriment, discouraging people from investing in the U.S. by having a source-based, rather than elsewhere, by having a source-based tax? And, well, the problem is it's possible this will only have clientele effects. In other words, it's possible that all this will do is not affect how many assets are in the U.S. versus elsewhere, but rather which assets Americans own. For example, if everyone but Americans can avoid any tax by investing in the Caymans, but we can't, we're going to pay the U.S. tax even if we invest there, then U.S. versus foreign individual, foreign taxpayers are going to have different relative valuations of Caymans investments versus U.S. investments. Obviously, by Caymans investments, I'm using a term of art since not a whole lot of infrastructure there, but investments deemed to be Caymans investments. So what will happen is that all else equal, the Americans will find the low tax assets less attractive because, gee, we're paying the U.S. tax anyway. Other taxpayers will find those foreign assets more attractive from the tax difference since they can take advantage of it. So it's possible that all you'll get is not less investment fleeing the U.S., not more tax revenues in the U.S., not more investment in the U.S., but simply a reallocation of assets. And if that happens, then our attempt to impose worldwide residence-based tax on our people would prove to have had no efficiency advantages. We wouldn't have done what we wanted to, which is to prevent investment and revenues from leaving the U.S., because we ended up with exactly the same situation as we would have had otherwise, except for different ownership of assets. That's what happens if you get only clientele effects. Well, would this happen if we had a world, in my hypothetical, would we end up getting no effect on the amount invested in the U.S.? And the answer is, I don't know. It's an empirical question. No one knows. It's an empirical question whether you would get any change. And unfortunately, it's an empirical question based on a hypothetical, namely a flow-through tax where individuals are taxed in corporate income. So I don't think you can really resolve an empirical question that's based on a legal counterfactual about what the rules actually are. So we don't know the answer to that question. The result, in sum, if individuals were taxed directly on corporate income, there would be a distributional reason for a worldwide tax. Namely, we would want to make sure that people were trying to, since we're trying to measure income, we try to figure out who the richer people are who should pay more relative to the poorer people. We want to be able to count their income even if they earned it abroad. So there's a distributional reason for the worldwide residence-based tax, and there might be an efficiency reason. That depends on whether imposing a worldwide tax purely on U.S. residents, given that we can't impose it on everyone else, on whether that ended up increasing our tax base and investment relative to not doing it or not. And we don't know the answer to that question. But now let's return to the real world after that lengthy detour and ask what happens when you have an entity-level corporate tax where residence is determined at the entity level? How does this affect the analysis? Well, distribution, what it now means, is instead of taxing U.S. shareholders on both their Siemens income and their GE income, and instead of taxing U.S. shareholders on all their income from wherever it arises and German shareholders only on their U.S. income. Instead, what we're doing is we're treating GE as a U.S. company and that's subject to worldwide tax, and Siemens not. So what we need to think through is what happens when we, A, lose the income tax when U.S. individuals invest through Siemens. They're now outside when they invest in Siemens and Siemens earns money abroad, we have no tool for bringing it into the U.S. tax base currently at the entity level via a worldwide residence-based tax because Siemens isn't a U.S. resident. So we lose that. On the other hand, we gain something. When Germans invest in GE, if we're taxing GE on its worldwide income, we're indirectly taxing those Germans in their entire worldwide income. So we've gained something and we've lost something. And what difference does it make? Well, for U.S. individuals who are investing through Siemens, the inability to tax their foreign source income that they earn through a foreign corporation such as Siemens mean we can no longer defend the income tax via worldwide taxation if, and you, I put that in capital letters for a reason, if they are sufficiently willing and able to invest abroad through foreign entities. In other words, I'm not claiming that it is in fact a fatal flaw, which I think would clearly be overstating it, but that particular gap can no longer be solved by worldwide residence-based tax. So it's a question of how serious an omission it is, but it does mean that if U.S. individuals choose to invest abroad through foreign companies, we can no longer defend the income tax to that extent. To the extent they're doing that, they're willing to invest abroad, but they're also willing to use foreign entities. To that extent, we're no longer defending the income tax successfully, which weakens, obviously, the distributional case. Now, obviously, residency electivity is going to matter. If it were complete, the tax would now be pointless. If all Americans said, whenever I want to invest abroad, I'm going to do it through a foreign company, and that were easy, and they could just do that, then basically this particular game would be over. Of course, we're not at that stage yet, but that's why residency electivity matters. Next, the next question is, what about foreign individuals investing through GE? How do we like picking up money from them? Because we're taxing GE and thus indirectly taxing them. Well, if foreigners happen to like investing through U.S. entities, why not charge them for it? Assuming that we can actually stick them with the charge economically, that the incidence of it is on them, that means less for them, but more for us, which from a national welfare standpoint may sound like a good thing. Now, of course, U.S. states charge for incorporation, but they may charge too little because they're competing with each other. So in effect, it's like cartelizing the 50 states plus D.C. in order to charge more for the value of U.S. incorporation to foreign individuals when they would be willing to pay for it. Obviously, you'd have to ask, how much are they willing to pay for it, if anything? So once again, electivity matters. Is this something they will pay for? Though, even if it is, you'd have to ask, why would the optimal levy on foreigners be a residual income tax on the company's foreign source income? Obviously, if you were trying to design a way to extract wealth from foreigners by making them pay for the value of U.S. incorporation, you can make it sound a little more high-minded by saying, well, we have to maintain our rule of law, which is what they find so appealing, and you could give it a gloss of benefit taxation or something, if that made you feel better. But the question of what fee you would want to charge these foreigners would really be a function of what value they place on U.S. incorporation, what they're willing to pay for it. It would be surprising if the optimal levy would be a residual income tax on the company's foreign source income. So you'd have to kind of pretty much, to be going down this road, you have to pretty much assume we're not going to be hitting them otherwise, which is probably true. Okay, so the last piece of the why worldwide analysis is the effect on efficiency of imposing a worldwide tax on corporate residents rather than individuals. We have the same efficiency question as before, the Peggy Richmond Musgrave problem. Can you weaken tax competition, reduce erosion of the U.S. tax base and tax revenues by reason of the idea of investing abroad to avoid the U.S. tax? Can we mitigate that when we have the only worldwide tax we can levy is on resident corporations? Well, in this setting, and for individuals, I said, gee, we don't know if a worldwide tax on U.S. individuals only would end up affecting U.S. investment in the flow-through model. I said, I don't know what the answer is. Here we have more reason for skepticism that it'll actually work, and that is that instead of just having the theory that U.S. individuals will swap assets with foreign individuals relative to what they would have done if not for the fact that we're in a worldwide system and they're not, we can now also imagine the same people, be they U.S. or foreign, investing through foreign entities when they otherwise would invest it through U.S. entities. You can actually have capital, the amount of capital involved, being outside the U.S. because it flows into non-U.S. rather than U.S. corporations. And my reading of the empirical literature to date, which is based on the real world of entity-level corporate taxation, is that it suggests that imposing a worldwide tax on U.S. entities so that they can't escape the domestic tax by investing abroad probably fails to increase U.S. investment. This is mainly firm-level data. A lot of the articles ask things like, does a given firm, when it invests more abroad, invest less in the U.S.? They tend to find not. This literature isn't perfect. The questions you'd like it to answer cannot be studied directly. Nonetheless, there's considerable, I think, skepticism about the case that we're helping ourselves in efficiency terms at this key margin by trying to have a worldwide tax on corporations. So the main surviving rationale for worldwide taxation of U.S. companies pertains to distribution and U.S. individuals who invest abroad but kind of still stuck with wanting to use U.S. entities, or, of course, the idea of getting some money out of foreign individuals if they value U.S. incorporation enough. Okay, so that's kind of why we might want to have a, in very fast form, why we might want to have a residence, a worldwide residence-based corporate tax, what we might be trying to accomplish through it. And it, yeah, I think you can see, at least if you accept my arguments, that the arguments for it are turning out to be fairly weak, though it's definitely not zero. But then the question is electivity rising enough to change the analysis? In other words, if people just avoid the U.S., we don't like the worldwide tax, we just won't use U.S. corporations, at a certain point, the whole enterprise would be pointless. But what one would like to know is how elective it really is. And really the question is, to what extent is use of U.S. entities to do business activity outside the U.S., how is that affected by if we have a worldwide tax and others don't? And there are three possible arenas for electivity. I'm going to leave out, these are the four from before, except I'm leaving out the one about the foreign companies becoming U.S. companies, because I figure that's relatively minor. So we're interested in how do people think about new startups? What about U.S. companies trying to expatriate? And finally, the one that I admitted was semantically the hardest to call electivity, I really thought it was the same thing, which is who ends up making new investments abroad is between U.S. and foreign companies. So in each of these settings, if there's kind of no reason to be U.S., you could just easily get out like that if it's good for tax reasons and it has no bad effect on you. We'd have an elective system that's doomed to ineffectiveness and is not even worth trying, even though there are some aims we would like to advance through it. But the question is, how much does that apply? We'll start with new startups. Now, if you're starting a prospective global business like Bill Gates, the tax advisor should and very likely will urge you to consider incorporating abroad. And I've talked with various people who have more hands-on experience in this than I do, and they say that there are some niches where this is just the norm. If you're making investor funds or, of course, reinsurance, things like that, you just don't do it through a U.S. company. You do it, of course, through a foreign company, probably in a tax haven. Data show rising tax haven IPOs. Nonetheless, and I think this was sort of a change. I found it to be kind of less elective from talking to people than I thought it would be when I started out. There are a number of reasons why people still establish prospective global businesses and use U.S. incorporation, even though they're making the same mistake as Bill Gates in 1975. First is that they may not know they're going to be a multinational. That's kind of, you hit a home run. Like you have an ice cream thing, and then if it's really successful, you're Ben and Jerry's, and I guess you're selling in Europe. So that's one reason, is you don't really know you're a multinational. It's just that if you're wildly successful, you'll be. Second, foreign incorporation may raise operating costs, especially at the early stages. Your little startup that could actually become a global titan, in the early days, it's not just myopia. In the early days, you may really not want to put that on yourself, of having to deal with a Bermuda incorporation and meetings there and so forth. Third, there's still some advantages to U.S. incorporation. Branding, showing that you care about corporate governance, appeal to U.S. investors with home equity bias. An interesting point, by the way, which, again, Lou Steinberg, in our article I found interesting, said is that one reason for home equity bias persisting in U.S. markets is legal constraints that apply to institutional investors, which he thinks may be weakening over time. There may be, like, pension funds and the like that kind of have to invest in U.S. companies, so it's not that they have this this peculiar aversion to foreign companies or feel they don't know anything about them. It's that their rules, it kind of works better for them to invest in U.S. companies. Next, for much of the tax benefit, putting the IP abroad, the intellectual property abroad, before it's demonstrably valuable is good enough. In other words, this is the U.S. worldwide regime isn't really that tough, so you can kind of make sure a lot of your income will be foreign anyway, and E is really kind of a broader version of D, which is that it's not all that bad. It's not like if you're a U.S. company, you're going to get slaughtered with immediate worldwide taxation at U.S. rates. So the last two are really about the fact that companies are willing to pay what it costs today in some cases to incorporate in the U.S. They might not be willing to pay more. Nonetheless, I think it's clear that electivity remains non-trivially limited. There still is some tendency, really for the future Bill Gateses of the world, to possibly incorporate in the U.S. and then down the road possibly to face stronger income taxation if there's some kind of worldwide tax on their foreign earnings, which for a big home run hitting firm will end up being a big part of the overall story. Okay, expatriation by existing U.S. firms. Well, they're subject to, you just want to kind of do a flip and put your parent company in Bermuda and get all the foreign subs out from the U.S. chain, the U.S. did a fairly effective job a few years ago, which Treasury regulations then closed a couple of the remaining doors, the so-called anti-inversion statutes. Everyone I talk to tells me it's very effective. I've been told it sometimes affects you even when you're really not trying to play that game. And again, just to quote Lou Steinberg, who is an NYU associated person, one last time, he has an amusing speech at the TCPI in Washington that was printed in Taxes magazine, where he said, since he's an investment banker now, if someone asks him, can we do an inversion, he'll say, oh, that's very challenging. But he said, that's banker speak for, are you out of your mind? We can't do that. So it's very hard for existing U.S. companies to get out. Genuine foreign purchases work, or mergers with a foreign firm left on top. It's not just kind of a flipping around, having the same owners and so forth. If there's a genuine purchase by a foreign firm and they put the foreign firm on top, that can work. And indeed, there's data showing that that is affecting behavior on the ground, that there are purchases taking place by foreign firms that appear to reflect some tax motivation, and that there's a tendency for the foreign firm to be the one that ends up on top of the chain. Nonetheless, and so that shows that we are tax encouraging real expatriations. There is money to be made in the form of reduced U.S. taxes of having a foreign company buy a U.S. company, but it's still limited in scope. Again, Bill Gates and Microsoft, they're not going to genuinely sell themselves to someone just in order to avoid the U.S. tax. So it's clear that existing U.S. equity is to a significant degree trapped here. Not fully, but to a significant degree. It's costly to get out. It may require doing things they don't want to do, and they will not do these things unless the tax hit is larger than the cost they perceive in doing it. So the result is, to a considerable degree, existing U.S. companies can't get out, or they can get out, but it's costly, and they mostly are not getting out. Well, what about new investment by existing companies? It's a crucial margin. It's really important, but it's the one we know about the least. I really don't know of any empirical information about this, and the economists I talked to told me this would be a challenging, not impossible, but a challenging thing to research. Basically, the hypothesis, in a way, would be that Siemens will grow faster than GE if it's in a territorial system and GE is in a worldwide system, or rather, it'll grow abroad faster than GE relative to what each would have done if they were under the same tax regime. So the notion is that the question is, to what extent is new equity and new foreign projects being funneled through foreign companies rather than through U.S. companies because of the tax difference? And this is something that's important to know about. Unfortunately, I'm not aware of any information to really give a good handle on what's going on, although, again, for economists, it's not an impossible research question to look at pieces of it and get suggestive data. But it is logical to me that if you have worldwide equity markets and people care about their after-all taxes return, that the U.S. worldwide tax element, if it's significant enough to matter, and of course if it's not, then really the whole thing is not accomplishing any positive purposes either, it's quite plausible that this would have an effect. I don't know how large an effect it is, but an effect, that there's got to be some degree there that's growing as world capital markets become more integrated and people become more familiar with foreign companies and comfortable with investing through them. Now, we had a very interesting Tillinghast lecture here 2 years ago by John Samuels. He argued that a key argument for exemption, for having a territorial system instead of a worldwide system, was that U.S. shareholders of U.S. companies are losing rents due to the tax disparity here. He may have even, since he is at GE, he might have even talked a bit about GE and Siemens. And I can't remember where I heard about China, the infrastructure grid there, but perhaps he even mentioned that. But he said that this is really making U.S. individuals less wealthy. Siemens is going to get it, not GE, and that's going to make the U.S. people in the U.S. less rich, and people in Germany more rich. I'm skeptical of that line of argument, but it would take too long to go through it here of the first instance, so I'd be happy to address it in Q&A or at the dinner if people want to. But anyway, I don't think that the United States is hampering its economic growth in a huge way, making our country dramatically poorer or anything like that because the U.S. companies aren't the ones getting those big investments in China. Nonetheless, the more elective it is, the more pointless the worldwide system is, and the more potentially costly. So I think, to the extent that we think electivity here is high rather than low, that clearly weighs against continuing with the worldwide tax, because you kind of have the U.S. companies growing more slowly and ceasing to be really where the action is. The tax is no longer accomplishing what it's meant to accomplish. So the bottom line is that rising electivity matters, but frankly, I think I've become persuaded that there's a little less of it, and it's not growing as fast as I kind of in a flip way thought, oh, of course, why would anyone invest in the U.S. if they have worldwide? That was kind of my feeling going in. I think I've learned it's a little more complicated than that. So the fact that there is likely rising electivity surely weighs against retaining a worldwide system. But the significance of it depends not only on how bad the electivity is, but also on how strong you'd otherwise find the case for worldwide. Now, my view, I've partly laid out already, which is that there's really not a whole lot to be gained by it, except for the idea that we're making it harder for U.S. individuals to avoid the U.S. income tax, which, again, I don't write off altogether, and that maybe we're getting a little money to foreign individuals if they really like U.S. companies. That alone, I think, makes me not that huge a fan of the worldwide system. I don't see it as accomplishing a great deal. Nonetheless, my real view for coming out, as I'll show in favor of exemption, is a little different. So here's the following thought experiment. Suppose the U.S. could repeal the foreign tax credit and deferral, but without automatically raising the, and in other words, foreign tax is merely deductible, no deferral, immediately worldwide tax. But to prevent that from making the tax burden on foreign source income higher than it is today, you simply lower the rate. So you lower the rate for foreign source income, and in order to get whatever burden on that income you want from a U.S. standpoint, you simply don't use deferral and foreign tax credits to be your devices for having the tax rate on foreign source income be as high as it could otherwise be. Exemption is such a system. It's an example of the system. It's a system where you repeal foreign tax credits and deferral, and you tax foreign source income at a lower rate than U.S. source income, i.e., the rate is zero. But it doesn't have to be zero. Zero is just one choice among many. So I would say, kind of as a logical matter, you could imagine the tax rate on foreign source income being zero or one or two or 50 or, well, I probably don't want it to be up there, but it's probably logically bounded more or less with zero on the one hand and the domestic rate of 35 on the other hand. And in a kind of a repeal of FDCs and deferral that didn't increase the burden on foreign source income, the rate would have to be quite a bit below 35. Now, the fact that there's some value to this, that to some extent we're stopping U.S. individuals from avoiding income tax and that foreigners might pay something for U.S. incorporation, suggests the optimal outbound rate might be greater than zero. So in that sense, exemption is not kind of anything like a first best system. Well, we're miles from a first best here. But it strikes me in that setting, you might say, why would the rate be zero when we still have some market power, our electivity is still incomplete, there's still some purposes the thing could serve. You'd kind of have to do a complex thought process and research process to figure out what the rate should be. But that's not a realistic, once again, I've used an unrealistic scenario to illustrate something about the world we actually are in. Any worldwide system that we're actually going to have in this country will use foreign tax credits and deferral. It will not, rather, instead of using a rate between 0 and 35 to fine-tune the burden on foreign source income. And you see it all the time. If a given presidential administration wants to raise the tax burden on foreign source income relative to what it was before, what do? They play around with the foreign tax credit rules, and they play around with deferral, or subpart F, which is obviously the same thing. So these are the instruments that are used to fine-tune it, not the rate, which actually I think would be possibly a better system. Well, as soon as you have foreign tax credits and deferral in your system, you're going to have a horrendous ratio of tax planning, administration, and compliance costs to revenue raised. These two sets of rules give rise to a lot of tax planning costs. They also give rise to a lot of waste. In deferral, it's relatively obvious. You have companies not bringing money home or coming through complicated jumping through hoops to bring the money home. For foreign tax credits, you have both all the craziness of the foreign tax credit system with the baskets and foreign tax credit limits and all that. And of course, you have the fact that a U.S. company that will have an immediate foreign tax credit values paying available in full right away will value a dollar of foreign tax liability as worth zero, because they're immediately going to get it back from the federal government. So part of the problem with foreign tax credit is not just the planning and the baskets and all that, but the fact that it induces U.S. companies, to the extent they'll be refunded by the U.S. government in full, to be non-foreign tax cost averse, cost conscious, which is bad from our standpoint because we're not the ones who get the money. But one of the odd things, so with foreign tax credits and deferral, they not only have all kinds of bad efficiency effects and create a lot of tax planning and compliance issues relative to the revenue raised, but they also, to make things kind of more puzzling, they tend to offset each other. So whenever you kind of mess with one of them, you make one of them tougher, you make the other one worse. For example, the Obama administration was proposing to make it harder for people to cherry pick which foreign source income they brought home and claim the most possible foreign tax credits. And Marty Sullivan in Tax Notes pointed out, well, that's going to lead to more deferral problems because now companies can't use the foreign tax credits to bring the money home tax-free. Likewise, a foreign tax credit, if it's available immediately and in full, it has what I call 100% marginal reimbursement rate. You get 100% of your money back, so you have no reason to care what foreign taxes you pay, but deferral reduces that. If you're going to keep the money abroad for a long time, you actually do care about your foreign tax costs because the U.S. isn't going to reimburse them right away, maybe not ever, if you never have to bring the money home. So you have these two terrible rules that create terrible distortions that offset each other. Each one makes the other one less bad, but when you have the two of them together, you're basically guaranteed to have a really bad system that has bad in the sense that it is a really high ratio of tax planning compliance and other such costs to revenue being raised. And that's definitive of an inefficient system. So my view is that since deferral and foreign tax credits is kind of a constraint, that you're going to, the only way to get rid of them is by having an exemption system. That basically means that exemption is an appealing alternative, because even if zero is not the optimal rate in foreign source income, you're kind of not going to be able to get rid of these lousy rules except by going to zero, just out of the political or administrative constraint. Anyway, rising electivity tends to lower the optimal tax rate for foreign source income, makes it closer to zero than it would otherwise be, and for that reason, I see it as strengthening the indirect case for exemption. Now, your mileage may admittedly vary. Obviously, we could spend 14 lectures talking each week about territorial versus worldwide systems and the like. So given my prior that I think that the worldwide system doesn't accomplish much to begin with, and also it, as a practical matter, commits us to these awful ways of implementing it, for me, then a little electivity kind of makes the case for exemption even stronger. But if you have stronger priors in favor of a worldwide system, I think you could logically say, well, electivity is bad, but I've yet to see evidence is bad, that it's bad enough to change my bottom line result. But suppose we do shift to exemption, right or wrong. What about the trapped U.S. companies with unrepatriated foreign earnings? And this, of course, or not of course, is what we in the biz call the issue of transition. So that's my fourth and last topic, is transition. Now, the problem of transition in a nutshell is that nominally prospective law changes, which only apply after the effective date of the enactment, can retroactively affect the tax consequences of pre-enactment decisions. And the classic example everyone always likes is tax-exempt municipal bonds. This year, I buy a municipal bond, and it's supposed to be give tax-free income. Next year, Congress repeals the exemption. Well, of course, they're not going to apply it to past taxable years, but I'm still getting income from this municipal bond for a number of years. Or if I sell it to someone, they're going to anticipate that as well. So do I get nailed? Do I have to pay tax on the supposedly tax-free income when they repeal the exemption? When I bought the bond, that can't be good, I suppose. Maybe that's the prelude to the hook to drag me off the stage. But hopefully I won't detain you that much longer. Anyway, so that's the transition question. Well, that's a case where taxpayers would have a transition loss if the new rule applied post-enactment years to the consequences of pre-enactment decisions. With exemption for U.S. companies, it's the other way around. They incorporated here and they invested abroad and they have foreign earnings, and they did so, presumably, unless they were kind of confident that the law would change, they kind of did so in the expectation that foreign earnings would be taxed upon repatriation, that if they ever repatriate, they'd have to pay tax at that point. I'm told by people I consulted about this some months ago that U.S. companies are thought to have more than $10 trillion invested abroad, including as much as $1 trillion in unrepatriated foreign earnings. So the question is, suppose you decide you want to enact an exemption system, because going forward, you don't really want to make companies reluctant to incorporate in the U.S. or to have all the bad effects that the U.S. rules have. Why would you excuse the expected tax on these earnings just because we like exemption going forward and haven't gotten around to collecting the tax under current law yet? Well, there are three leading perspectives that suggest to me denying the transition gain. The first is the so-called old view, or reliance. Just like people will say, oh, it's unfair to tax municipal bond interest if I bought the bond on the view that it would be tax-exempt forever, it kind of applies in reverse to transition gain. If companies invested and shareholders bought stock in those companies on the view that, or in the knowledge that the U.S. is a worldwide system and is not pledged to eliminate anytime soon, why should they suddenly get a windfall gain by having them said, guess what, the tax you expected is gone, you can now bring your money home tax-free. And this came up really in a kind of a many ways the same issue. Corporate integration, getting rid of the double tax domestically on corporate income that's taxed at the company level, then dividends and capital gains to the shareholders. And such leading people who I certainly admire is Bill Andrews of Harvard Law School and David Bradford of Princeton and NYU, thought it was important, for reasons they explained, to prevent this unfair so-called windfall gain to shareholders from adopting corporate integration and not taxing the prior corporate earnings. Well, I can quarrel in some ways if I had more time to discuss it with some of their analysis, but nonetheless, I think it's a powerful point, and it kind of suggests here that we shouldn't let this stuff escape tax-free that reflects pre-enactment decisions. A second perspective that's more popular among economists and maybe a few law professors than the general public is lump sum taxation, aka expropriation. if you take someone's house from them, they didn't see it coming, and you promise I'll never, ever, ever do it again, and they believe you, there's no distortion, because they didn't expect it, and you've apparently succeeded in convincing them that it wouldn't happen. So one-time takings can be efficient if they're unanticipated, and if you, the hard part, you can make people believe that you're never, ever going to do it again. And then you don't need distortive taxes. Well, this certainly weighs against the one-time giveaway. This is like a lump sum giving. It's like companies invest under the view that they're discouraged by some taxes out there, and then you tell them, guess what? The tax is gone. We're giving a kind of a lump sum transfer to you. Given that to raise revenues, normally the instruments available to us normally are ones that impose distortion, like taxing profitable economic activity, it kind of seems from this perspective not to make a whole lot of sense. So in principle, you might want to take that away, and the only thing is you wouldn't want to overshoot the mark by so much as to make them think that you're really playing the lump sum tax game. If you grossly overshoot the mark, you're basically telling them that in other words, you get more than you expected to, that you risk telling them to expect that you'll do it again. So that's a second perspective that I think once again says why have a lump sum giveaway? Even if a lump sum tax is kind of questionable because people won't believe you, why would you have a lump sum giveaway? The perspective I like the most, which I've written about at more length than you probably care to know, is the so-called new view, which it talks about the incentive effects of anticipation. What if people can see changes coming and they're anticipating the transition rule? How do you affect their incentives? So this is an incentive-based view. Obviously, people who are going to buy municipal bonds, the price for the bonds and their willingness to buy them and how many bonds will be issued might depend on what people think would happen if there's a repeal, what the transition rule would be for a repeal. Now, I think there, what makes the analysis complicated here is their offsetting effects. So suppose people are investing in U.S. companies today, and they're thinking, gee, maybe they'll go to exemption, and maybe if they do, they either will or won't have a transition hit on earnings to the day of the enactment. Prior to the enactment of exemption, the idea that there'd be the so-called windfall gain, and windfall may be the wrong word for it if people are betting on this, the prospect of a transition tax would increase discouragement of new U.S. equity. You'd kind of say to yourself, gee, if I issue or buy new U.S. equity and it earns a lot of money, and then they adopt exemption later, they're going to nail me anyway on the stuff that was earned before that effective date. So actually, the incentive effect of the giveaway is actually desirable insofar as decisions to use U.S. equity are concerned. On the other hand, it's undesirable. It creates bad incentives in another margin. You have a U.S. company with lots of earnings abroad. It's one thing to say, gee, should we bring any of the money home? One thing they're going to ask is, what if the tax goes away? And if you tell them, if you bring it home this year, we're going to tax you, but don't worry, we might change our system, and if we do, all those earnings you didn't bring home this year will get away tax-free in the future. That would obviously be an enormous discouragement to taxable repatriations of U.S. funds, because you're telling people, you pay the tax today, but if you just wait, it might go away. So telling them that the tax on earnings to date is not going to go away, that even if we change systems, we're going to hit you on the old stuff, has desirable incentive effects at this margin. Namely, it tells companies, don't postpone repatriation of foreign earnings just on the view that maybe the tax will go away. Because even if it goes away, it'll only be for new earnings. So it has a desirable effect at that. Now, how do you choose between these two? Well, my own feeling is that the latter is really a margin at which I'd kind of expect a lot more responsive behavior. So that's why I think the new view kind of favors having the transition tax. If there are all these people kind of incorporating the U.S. when they shouldn't and they're not really paying much attention or they're very constrained, you have that on the one hand. On the other hand, you have companies that are very mindful about what's the best tax strategy for repatriating their funds. I would say that probably the more important effect is to tell companies, don't postpone your repatriations just because you think exemption might take place, because even if it does, you're not going to benefit from waiting. Now the problem is, how do you preserve the by the way, one thing I could have thrown into the mix here is, look at the U.S. fiscal situation, if you, not a good idea in an empty stomach, of course, do you really want to be giving away revenue in the middle of everything else? One could certainly add that to the picture. But so the problem is, how do you preserve expected tax revenues without having to keep a complex system in place indefinitely? Not to worry, only admittedly in very sketchy form, I have a modest proposal and a couple of fallbacks. Well, this is sort of the economist on the notepad. The best solution is a one-time tax on unrepatriated foreign earnings and profits. In other words, you say, you have foreign earnings, they have to keep track of their earnings and profits for purposes of tracking future dividends. You have earnings and profits of X dollars. Guess what? We're imposing a one-time tax on that today, and then the exemption system starts. That kind of ends up having no effects on incentives and behavior after that happens. Now, to make this simple, you kind of want to say no foreign tax credits, no deferral. Well, of course, no deferral since it's due immediately, but since we're not trying to increase their tax by the back door, the rate you'd apply wouldn't be 35%. It would be lower because you're, in effect, cashing out. You're saying, on average, you would have paid, say, 20%, so we're going to wipe out the foreign tax credits. We're going to charge you the lower percentage, so if everyone put together, it'll come out about the same. So anyway, U.S. companies are supposed to have this information. So how much revenue would you raise? You have this tax base of about $1 trillion in foreign earnings. That multiplied by the rate would be the amount of revenue you'd get. So I kind of think that because you don't want people to think you're playing games where you're actually taxing them, you're doing ex post expropriations, you kind of want to stay roughly in line with what they expected to pay anyway in present value terms. And also I think there's nothing wrong with charging them for making them pay money instead of incurring costly compliance, administrative, and tax planning burdens, because that doesn't make them worse off. Obviously it's better for the U.S. government to get a dollar in its pocket than for the company to simply waste the dollar. But in looking what can we hit companies with without it really being a tax increase, I think it's fair to kind of think about the compliance administrative costs they are saving. Well, this is super preliminary and back of the envelope, but based on a combination of Harry Grubert, Rosen Altshuler paper talking about what would be a burden-neutral repeal of deferral rate, and some work I've done with Kim Clousing, the economist from Reed College, who is responsible for all the numbers part of it, about what would be a burden-neutral replacement of the foreign tax credit, I think it could well be that the rate, the one-time rate on foreign earnings of, say, 15 or 20% might well not really be a tax increase for them, considered as the present value of all future taxes they would have expected to pay to the U.S., along with the present value of the tax planning, compliance, and administrative costs they would have expected. So my very tentative hypothesis, because the numbers are pretty much back of the envelope, if that. In fact, I don't recall using an envelope when I did this, is that a plausible transition tax might well raise something like $200 billion. By the way, that happens to be the 10-year revenue estimate for the Obama administration. Their original tax reform plans for international would have raised $200 billion over 10 years. Now, of course, that was a very different number. You didn't get it all up front. You got it deferred. In addition, though, their rules would apply outside the 10-year window. It would keep raising revenue, whereas this is once and out. But nonetheless, it shows that, you know, we're potentially talking about significant money here. And the payment of the transition tax could have, well, what about the recession? What about companies that are cash flow squeezed? In principle, and again, this is a thought experiment at this point, although one I would like to be taken more seriously, is that you could defer it with interest and certainly not make them pay it today. In fact, it doesn't really matter when they pay it as long as the deferral is with interest and doesn't lower the present value of it. So that's kind of like the first best, if politics weren't a problem, transition scheme, though I've been told by someone that there are some people in Washington actually looking at this sort of thing. And the companies might complain about being hit up, but if it's done right, they're really not losing anything. They're just playing up front the present value of what they would have expected to pay in any event. And obviously, you don't have to get it exactly right. And I certainly don't think you have to get it right company by company. Well, if this is unfeasible, then what are some messier alternatives? Well, Bill Andrews, again, I said corporate integration with existing corporate earnings is kind of the same problem. Bill had a complicated proposal of an ingenious proposal for corporate integration without windfall gain to existing equity and on existing earnings and profits. He wanted to limit the new tax benefit to normal returns on post-enactment new equity. People complained about whether this would work, would there be various tax planning devices to play games with it. All I want to say at this point is that that type of scheme, wow, I'm really in trouble now, I guess. I'm almost done. Can you just trust me? So it's not clear whether such rules would work. They'd certainly be worth thinking about. And finally, more imperfect still, you could simply have the repatriate, you could simply tell, say, company, you have $1 billion, say you have $500 million of foreign earnings now. The first $500 million of dividends that you pay home will be taxed at a positive rate, but after that, it'll be exemption. And I think that's certainly a very imperfect proposal, but compared to cold turkey zero right away, I think it's also worth considering. And in conclusion, take that. Electivity is important prospectively. It's surely rising, though there are reasons for expecting continued U.S. incorporation of the future home-run global companies like the Microsofts of the future. Second, concern about rising electivity strengthens the case for shifting to a territorial system, but the issues on the other side can't really be entirely dismissed. You may decide they're outweighed, but they're not silly or zero concerns. They're concerns that do matter. Third, the arguments for shifting to a territorial system do not provide good support for handing a windfall gain to existing U.S. companies. And finally, it's conceivable that we could be talking about real money here. And on that note, I will conclude.
Well, thank you very much, Dan. That was certainly a meaty presentation. We traditionally have some Q&A, questions and answers, and I'm going to open the floor if anyone has any questions they want to ask, because if they don't, I'm going to jump right in. Yeah.
I'm not, forgive me if you're not being familiar with those in particular. The obvious one that comes to mind is a headquarters rule. And I'd note, though, that countries with headquarters rules, like the UK, have been a little unhappy with people thinking about leaving. Headquarters rules, actually, as David Tillinghast wrote about 25 years ago, any headquarters rule is going to be a little bit imperfect in terms of identifying where the action is really taking place. Another problem is that headquarters may actually have, there's an argument that it's desirable for a country to have corporate headquarters there, that there are kind of positive spillover effects. And if you're doing that, then there's sort of an extra reason not to want to tax discourage them. So yes, actually this talk, I'm sorry, ended up being a little longer than I meant it to be. I didn't talk about those issues, and actually the current draft of the paper doesn't really talk about them quite enough either. But yes, that's something, I think under any plausible approach, you're going to have these problems. So the headquarters rule, I question how well that would work. If you actually were doing flow through to the individuals, well, it's kind of difficult to have corporate residence depend upon where most of the shareholders are. That may change for a public company. They may hold through blocker vehicles, et cetera. So it strikes me that having it depend on true shareholder residence is not going to be work. If there are any other possibilities you have in mind, they're kind of worth thinking about. Well, it's true that since we don't have any of those problems today, no, I'm kidding. I think another way of putting your question, and you'll correct me, but I think it's really the same question, is what about the effect of the worldwide residence-based tax on making it harder for U.S. companies to avoid having U.S. taxable income, U.S. source taxable income? Is that really what you're...
Well, unless you solve the intercompany pricing problem, yeah.
Well, that is a problem of source. We have that problem today. That is a problem of source. And we have source problems no matter what. So the question is, what can the worldwide residence-based tax do for us about that? And the answer is that for U.S. resident companies that are trapped, it has some ability to make it harder for them to disguise their income as foreign source income, but only for those companies. For non-U.S. companies, obviously the worldwide residence-based tax doesn't do anything at all. So once again, you're kind of, the electivity undermines this. What I would say, and it's really obviously a different topic, is that the U.S. and other countries need to do the best job they can of having residence-neutral rules for dealing with multinationals. In other words, you really need to be able to look at the entire corporate group, whether there's a U.S. parent on top or not, look at the entire group and decide how to do the income split. To combat treating your U.S. income as foreign source income just for U.S. resident companies isn't really going to do the job enough in the long run. So I think that the problem you call for is a very real one. The problem you point to calls for is for having rules, source rules, that apply to all multinationals that are in the U.S., rather than relying on the residence-based tax to solve it for one piece of the group.
Take one more question from the floor, then I'm insist going to ask my own question. Yes.
Yeah. To continue on what the other two are saying, what Michael is basically saying and what our first questioner is basically saying is you cannot, however much you may want to go territorial and you can screw up any kind of system, and we have as our... Deputy Assistant Secretary, is that his title, keeps telling us a DIY exemption system anyway.
Yeah.
You can't go territorial with the existing infrastructure of rules, of screwed up source rules, which are very, which are illogical, of easy residence rules where it's just place of organization instead of management and control, or what we have in our treaties, place of operational management. And when you start thinking, and then your transfer pricing problem gets worse, and the British are already saying this. They just went territorial, and their transfer pricing is even worse. Unless you start attacking those, then you just don't have anything left, because, as you say, all new investment goes offshore. But, you know, that should be the focus, and not, you know, well, some of this philosophical stuff is, how are you going to collect whatever you're going to still try to collect here?
I really agree with, I mean, there are different topics you could give a talk about, and I chose that one, but I agree with you that fixing the source rules is very important, and that because of the existing U.S. companies that are trapped here, going to a territorial system may make it even more important than it would be otherwise. It's something that ought to be fixed in the event. Now, I completely agree with you, that's an important problem, and I guess what I was saying to Mike is we're not really able to fix it well enough via worldwide residence-based corporate taxation. And you're making the point, which I agree with, that, well, if we're going to make that shift, we have to take these problems more seriously. So I agree with that.
I'm going to exercise the prerogative of the chair
the
here and ask, my own, and ask
that.
My own question, which is you began the paper and the lecture by citing the William Woods, the head of the Bermuda Stock Exchange, saying that Bill Gates made a terrible mistake by forming Microsoft in New Mexico.
By the way, I'm not sure he really did.
Well, that's my question. Exactly what is he talking about? How much money and what money exactly does this gentleman think Bill Gates left on the table? Because the last time I looked at collections on tax from U.S. multinationals, they weren't very significant. So if they're not very significant, what is the impetus that's going to drive the next Bill Gates abroad?
Well, first of all, there are two reasons why Bill Gates, I mean, it's partly a laugh line to open the thing with, but I think it makes a valid point, but obviously Wood is smoking something when he says that Bill Gates would be vastly richer if he incorporated
richer
the Bermuda. And also, of course, Microsoft would have had a hard time getting off the ground if they had done that. Well, the fact is that it's widely reported by investment bankers, for example, that a lot of U.S. companies wish they could expatriate. They were doing it several years ago until it was shut down. There is some value to it. And of course, if the U.S. worldwide regime were made more challenging than it is, there would be more who wanted to do it. You're right that the regime is kind of weak, but of course that's sort of a double-edged point in the sense that, well, it's kind of this dumb system. It's not really very effective. It's not doing very much harm. It's not really driving many people away. Well, in that case, it's not doing much good either. It actually has to be effective in order to be doing any harm. So this is kind of on both sides of the ledger. So you could say to have any. I agree that that guy was promoting Bermuda a bit.
Well, look, this is obviously the beginning of even a longer discussion, I think I'm going to call it quits for now. We have a reception at the back of the room, and I thank you all for coming, and I thank Professor Shaviro for a very, very stimulating talk and paper.